cuando le escucho, me habla y me lleva a donde guarda sus tesoros. Y el viento canta y completa su poema con el polvo del desierto. Envuelto en un aire antiguo, enriquecido por el olor de romero, la salvia, mezquite y el chapote. Abrazado por sus cordilleras, sus llanos, sus ríos, bosques y lagos. Encantado por su espíritu, por su mágica y misterio. Inspirado por sus leyendas y por su historia. Un paraíso, un refugio del tiempo, del prejuicio, porque aquí ya está y siempre ha estado. Le llevo conmigo en el corazón y le llevo conmigo hasta el panteón. We were hanging out in North Mexico, exploring the canyons of Sonora and playing in the waters of the Sea of Cortez. We were here when Maarten de Moor received news from the Siesmic and Volcanic Observatory of Costa Rica. The group invited Maarten to interview for a postdoctoral position based in San Jose, Costa Rica. Maarten was a few months out from finishing his PhD and had been studying active volcanoes in Europe, Africa, and Latin America. After interviewing in his broken Spanish, he was soon offered the job, with the start date of June 1st, 2013. Immediately certain he wanted to make the move by car, Maarten invited Scott Jasechko and myself to join the adventure. We loved the idea. We thought it was crazy. Scott Jasechko came to the University of New Mexico from Victoria, British Columbia, to pursue a PhD in water chemistry. A smart guy, who played hard and worked hard. Scott was publishing his first author in the Journal of Nature by day and tearing up the discotecas by night. Also joining us was Maarten's younger brother, Alex de Moor. He had been working as a geologist for a mining company the last few years in Alaska. He was looking forward to resigning from his position and joining us on the road trip before beginning grad school in Washington. We all shared a great taste for adventure, science, and a good time. We made the perfect team and were ready for all the challenges that laid ahead of us. Planning the route proved to be difficult. We knew no one who had done it. There was little information out there. It was just so unheard of to travel from the United States to Central America by car. One resource we did find helpful was an ebook called Don't Go There, It's Not Safe, You Will Die, and other more rational advice for overlanding Mexico and Central America. One of our biggest concerns was crossing the border into North Mexico. For the last few years, most of northern Mexico is under siege by warring drug cartels. Once at peace, these organizations were engaged in bloody disputes over controlling trafficking corridors to feed the neighboring United States' uncontrollable drug habit, a $30 billion a year industry. Securing access to this market had proved just as cutthroat and violent as conflicts concerning stability in the world's crude oil and mineral commodities market. Obviously, the media loved covering drug violence in both Latin America and United States, so it was hard for family and friends not to be worried, as mainstream media seemed only to choose violence to report as news coming from Mexico. But it didn't matter what the news or anyone else had to say. We were going, and nothing could stop us.
This is my trusty old truck. Hopefully it's gonna take us all the way to Costa Rica without any kind of issues, but you never know with an old truck, so we'll see.
Maarten's truck was the perfect Central American cruiser. However, we needed one more vehicle to complete this journey. Luckily, the Garcia family from Santo Domingo Pueblo offered us one of their trucks. They had a 1984 Toyota pickup. However, this vehicle had been abandoned for 3 years down at the ranch by the Rio Grande River. It was a good truck, but it sure needed a lot of work.
Okay, and let's go check out the truck. Okay.
Hello. Ah, Motomavi, Dai Tyrone, Kokais.
That's right.
To ready this truck for Central America, it needed a complete overhaul. We spent many hours in AutoZone, shopping online, and going to the junkyard to find these parts. Help from my brother Tyler proved invaluable.
You did a little more drinking than you did working.
Here we are, trying to salvage some shit for a nice 1985 truck that we got off the pueb.
84.
Either way, it's haggard.
Pickings are slim.
Windchills and shit?
Yeah.
You take it out right away? Yole. Aquí no más.
We made good progress and good time with the truck. However, there was one pressing issue. Even with the rebuilt motor, the truck would still stall when it reached running temperature. We couldn't figure this out. So we decided to take the truck to the Toyota dealership. Maarten had to start work on June 1st. We were a month out, but we were confident we could make the time. So with the truck in the shop, we shifted our focus to our annual Cinco de Mayo pool party. We combine this with Maarten's going away party.
What is it? That's just the beef. Oh my god.
Our friend Carlos, El Maestro de la Cocina, offered to cook his famous carnitas and New Mexican red chili. We had plenty of good friends, booze, and amazing food. As per usual, the party doesn't start till the arrival of Sergio Antione, the party instigator.
Sergio, look at the rock!
It was 2013, by the way. The party was great. It was good to see everyone before we left on our long, epic journey to Central America.
You. We do not have the vehicle. Yeah, we're basically back to step one. They rebuilt the whole motor, did a whole bunch of stuff, took it out on
the... The day had arrived, May 8th. But the dealership could still not solve the mystery of why the truck would stall once at running temperature. We were all packed and ready to embark, but we were still stuck. Each day the dealership promised us, one more day and we'll get you guys on the road. So each evening we would hang out with friends and say goodbye again, believing it was our last night. Only to wake up and be disappointed again and again. It was like the universe was working against our journey.
We're stuck.
We're stuck. Again.
Finally, May 14th, the truck was ready. The dealership found debris in the gas tank and fuel line, which was choking the carburetor of fuel. With the problem solved, we were ready to begin leg one of the journey. Spirits were high. I think we made it some 5 miles. We didn't even make it to the freeway. The same thing kept happening. The truck would stall once at running temperature. We were back to square one when we first got our hands on this truck in Santo Domingo Pueblo. We were so very frustrated. The universe really was conspiring against us.
In the truck, we got the same problem. You know, it's where we were a month ago. It gets up to temperature and feels like it's running out of gas. So, I guess we're going back to American Toyota, getting a tow. In the meantime, I'm enjoying this outrageously thick milkshake. It's super tough to eat. You got anything to add, Alex?
What do we do every night, Pinky? Get drunk.
We got the truck back to the dealership. They were surprised as we were. They couldn't believe it was still stalling. Scott and I decided we were not going to leave the dealership until that truck was road ready.
Think it will?
It has to. At this point, it has to. Narrowed it down to when it dies, there's no gas in the carburetor. The line gets dunked up from the metal tubing. Stock fuel. And it's been sitting for so long, Santo Domingo is sitting there rusting and rotting, that's just clogging the fuel. So, this is it. We have to get out of here because our health is deteriorating, our minds are deteriorating, and we can't stop getting into shenanigans here in town. We gotta get out of here. We have to get out of here.
What's the word?
Put 40 miles on it with the new radiator.
Yeah.
No more stalling, no more overheating. So like I told you before, earlier today, is the fuel delivery problem was the clogged fuel line, and we were able to go around that and build a new line. Once we got that fixed and it was going over 10 miles before, it would stall.
Right.
Then it turned into an overheating problem, which was boiling the fuel out of the hole.
Yeah,
like a vapor lock.
Yeah.
So once we got the overheating
handle,
stalling condition went away.
Cool. So you think it could make it 6,000 miles?
Man, I've seen those trucks go forever in a day. And you got a new motor, good carburetor, and everything touched and taken care of, it's under the hood. So barring anything unforeseen happening, I think it'll go another 100,000 miles.
Awesome. Well, we'll be right in there.
This time it was for real. The truck really was ready. We were finally getting out of town. There was one last change we had to do to our plan. Alex couldn't come with us. His passport was about to expire. And being a citizen of the Netherlands, he had to fly to the consulate in Houston. Once he had his passport, the plan was he would fly and meet us wherever we were when he got it.
But are you guys heading to Juarez, or are you guys just gonna stay in El Paso?
So, just give us a shot as soon as that tracking number comes out.
Okay. Yeah, we'll do.
Now that the pickup truck was running fine, it was Martin's turn for mechanical issues. The 4Runner broke down pulling in for a pit stop in Truth or Consequences, New Mexico. Our first roadside repair consisted of changing out a fuel pump just 150 miles from Albuquerque. There we bedded down, and early the next morning we set off with our sights on crossing into Mexico, through Juarez, and pushing on to Torreon, Coahuila.
All right, that's it. No more United States for a month.
We pulled into Torreon around sunset. After some 13 hours of blasting through the Chihuahuan desert, trying to resist the urge to pull in at every other quesadilla and carne asada stand, we had no issues crossing the border and experienced no holdups with military or police checkpoints. While having dinner in Torreon, we did hear a shootout a few blocks from the hotel lasting well over a minute. That was our cue to call it a night and prepare for another long haul the next day into Querétaro, Mexico.
Today we're going to try and make it all the way to Querétaro, which is probably going to be a 9-10 hour drive, 700 kilometers or so.
After another 12-hour day of blasting through central Mexico, we arrived to Querétaro. We didn't do much apart from the usual cervezas and tacos as we were just so exhausted from driving. We also had to prepare ourselves for another 12-hour plus crusher into the Gulf Coast the following day. Onward into Coatzacoalcos, Veracruz. Having no air conditioning in the truck didn't bother us until we descended into the Gulf Coast. The air became increasingly hot and steamy. There was nothing we could do but sweat it out while being blasted by the sauna-like air. Arriving at Coatzacoalcos, we peeled ourselves out of the truck and rehydrated with cold mariscos and cervezas, compliments of the Quintal family.
Porque está baja la marea, cuando está arriba no se ve.
Low tide, that's why you can see them.
Este es el momento que se...
Bueno, ¿qué hay que hacer en Coatzacoalcos?
¿Qué hay que hacer? Tomar. ¿O tomas o te aburres?
While in Coatzacoalcos, we took the opportunity to have a mechanic take a look at the pickup truck. It was making a rattling sound. Something was loose in the mechanism between the drive shaft and the differential. Luckily, the part was swapped fairly easy and was inexpensive. Now that we had some time to appreciate where we were, the trip started getting fun and felt exotic. We were now in lush jungle, palm trees, and warm weather. Once we settled up in Coatzacoalcos, we hit the road and made our way to Palenque, the ancient Mayan city.
Hold your breath real quick. Here we are on the way to Palenque. It's been a rowdy drive. The highway was pretty nasty and
smoky,
a bunch of fires we had to drive through. Other than that, life is pretty good. So I'm gaining some like culture right now. So in many parts of the world, indigestion and diarrhea are you know, a weekly, if not, you know, every couple daily occurrence. And yeah, I came on this trip to get some culture, and that's what I'm getting right now. So I think if there's another Los Angeles producer, I'm gonna share my culture with Zach.
We're gonna replace the seat in the second time.
By the time we arrived at Palenque, we had just about muscled all the road we could possibly sustain that day, and the Palenque National Park was our refuge from the hot and smoky highways of South Mexico. We set up camp in the lush jungle. The air felt clean and the stream's water cool to the touch. Later that night, camping, we heard howler monkeys in the trees. We couldn't see them, we could only hear them. It sounded really creepy.
Camping near Palenque right now, and we had an amazing stay in Coatzacoalcos, staying with the Quintal family, and Scotty's very sick at the moment. He's puked 3 times in the last couple of hours, but the howler monkeys are amazing. They're just going off at the moment. You can hear them out there in the jungle.
Kind of sound like me, you know?
Beautiful. Palenque, a mid-sized ancient Mayan city, flourished for nearly 1,200 years up to around 800 AD. Palenque was long abandoned by the arrival of the Spanish in the 1520s. However, the Mayan culture and language still flourishes to this day. It's interesting that only 10% of Palenque's large structures have been explored by modern archaeology. The rest lie beneath a thick jungle canopy. Although I'm sure a lot of the local Mayan descendants know all of their ancestors' secrets. The Mayans kept detailed records of society and the natural world, but the motive for abandonment is still unclear, maybe a result of cultural and climate changes. This place was magical, and we were awestruck. Just imagining the city at its peak, the people, the sounds, the busy markets, the ceremonies, colors, music, and even the turbulent times which called for human sacrifice, all taking place in these very same steps and stones. It was like this place subtly commanded an immense respect that we were all in tune to. Like there really was a greater presence here beyond ourselves and the other visiting guests. After an amazing stay in Palenque, we set off to cross the Yucatan Peninsula towards Belize. We camped near a small town called Bacalar on the banks of a freshwater lagoon. We had received news from Alex. He had received his passport and picked up a flight to Belize City. We were to reunite with Alex the following day at the airport.
Band. gypsies.
Once at the border of Belize and Mexico, we got our first taste of Central American bureaucracy. These small government offices handling visas and vehicle import permits seem to just love to shuffle, staple, stamp, and photocopy everything possibly related to your nationality and vehicle, and it just seemed so redundant. We also had our first experience dealing with the civilian population, coming to us from every angle wanting to help us exchange money and assist us through the process, while swearing every other person was just trying to rob us. This was a little stressful, but humorous.
Thank you.
After getting the vehicle sprayed for bugs, we are off on the road in Belize and on our way to pick up Alex from the airport. While having dinner in San Ignacio, we befriended our waiter, Nolan, who agreed to join us out on a night in the town. We must have checked out every joint that was open at night and shut each one of them down.
Plain, you know, to put buzz.
As soon as the pads come off. Scotty, you hammered?
Nah.
Yeah, you are.
Nah.
Stop it.
He's white, are you?
How y'all doing?
Good, how are you?
Doing fine.
That night, Nolan also convinced us we should spend at least half of the next day exploring some of the nearby waterfalls and caves. So the next morning, we met up and went out for a little day excursion. Later that afternoon, we crossed the border into Guatemala. This border crossing was a little more stressful and intimidating than that of Belize. The lines were longer, the paper shuffling a little more complex, and the street population was a little more aggressive. Like in Mexico, there was a big military presence that made things seem a little more on edge. We got into Tikal late. We had broken one of our rules, no driving at night, but we had no other option. We set up camp and slept to the sound of howler monkeys in the trees above us. The following morning, we awoke to find ourselves once again surrounded by lush jungle. Wildlife seemed to come at us from every angle. Tikal was made a UNESCO World Heritage Site in 1979. It is often considered one of the world's greatest national parks. Tikal was one of the largest pre-Columbian Mayan cities. Its origins date back as far as 400 BC and thrived for around 1300 years, up until its abandonment coinciding with Palenque near 900 AD. Corroboration between the Mayan and Aztec records indicate Aztecs from Mexico's Teotihuacan intervened in Mayan politics here in Tikal and eventually conquered the city. The incredible views atop Tikal's temples can be seen in the movie Star Wars: A New Hope, in which Tikal features as the planet Yavin. Our second destination in Guatemala was the caves of Chimucjampe near Lankin. We took our chances on traveling by way of an obscure mountain road that appeared to traverse some interesting topography, and what we discovered was to be one of the most memorable points in our journey. The terrain was breathtaking and the people just as extraordinary. Spanish became less and less relevant the deeper we ventured into the mountains. We were in the heart of the Guatemalan Mayan culture.
Hola, señor. Gracias. Señor. ¿Conoce?
Buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes. ¿Qué tal? ¿Ya dónde va?
Vamos a las cuevas de Chimucjampe.
Ah, para la cruz de la Lankina. Un kilómetro.
¿Cuántos kilómetros?
Un kilómetro.
Un
kilómetro.
Muy bien. Y después
ahí en la baja.
A la baja, a la izquierda.
No, la arriba, no. No, es la baja, la izquierda.
A izquierda.
Sí, a la izquierda.
Ok, muy bien.
Es la baja de Saimuk Champeya. Y a Champeya, y a Moscahuoma.
Sí.
Son champeritas.
Qué bueno.
Ajá, pasé.
Pretty cool.
Yeah, it's paved over there.
Hola. Buenas tardes.
Buenas tardes.
¿Cómo están?
¿Qué tal? ¿Y dónde vamos?
Vamos a Lankin.
Ah.
Las cuevas.
Ah, sí, ah, las cuevas.
Sí.
Esas son la casa ahí, de vuelta ahí.
The truck took a beating that day. We were pounded by rain off and on, and had to creep around boulders and landslides that came into the road from the heavy rains. It was a long day. We traveled some 40 miles in about 8 or 9 hours.
Are you serious?
Our guide, Christian, was going to take us on a pleasant river float to the caves of Chimucjampe. However, the heavy mountain rains turned that river into a raging torrent. Christian improvised other activities for us.
I think maybe we don't need this.
Yeah.
We
gonna get weird in the cave.
Mira que hace.
I can barely breathe.
Mira.
Estalagmitas.
Estalagmita y estalactita.
Four men in a cave. What's gonna happen?
It's getting weird.
It's getting weird.
After a night in Lankin, we made our way to Copan. We overnighted in a park in the city center. Most of our camping gear was wet from the heavy mountainous rains, including our sleeping bags. Scott was again feeling sick and slept under a pile of clothes to keep warm.
Got a real good thing going here.
On an all-time low right now.
Leaving Copan, Guatemala, we made our way for Copan, Honduras. It felt like we were blasting through Central America at light speed. We had been on the road some 10 hours just about every day for the last 2 weeks, battling the eroded highways, traffic, the smoke, the humidity, the police and military checkpoints, the borders, the lines. It was exhausting. We spent our second night in Honduras camping near Buenaventura. We had some 3 days to be in San Jose, two more borders to cross, Nicaragua and Costa Rica.
It's real nice, you know?
Take care of your investment, you know?
So we're in Honduras right now. It's still strange to look at Google Maps and see where we are. Seen some amazing stuff. What's impressed me most has probably been the people. Seeing the different distinctions between the different countries, different cultures. And we're only getting a taste of it at this speed. With how fast we're driving through these countries.
We were beginning to feel the effects of living as the Central American road warrior, straight haggard. But we were confident. We had already championed 4 border crossings at this point. But we would soon learn we were just getting our baby teeth in regards to battling borders in Central America.
10 kilometers from the border of Nicaragua. The highway is full of potholes. It's two-way traffic, both directions. But just anything goes to avoid these potholes. It gets crazy.
The border of Honduras and Nicaragua was a nightmare. We arrived late in the afternoon. It was hot and we were tired. And the paper shuffling process was impossible. The Honduran customs officials were a handful of guys in civilian clothing. Each one of them tried grabbing our passports, paperwork, and demanded money. To leave the country of Honduras, we had to resign our visas and vehicle import permits. The customs officials, seeing we had all of our paperwork in order, began asking about non-existent and absurd documents, such as a notarized list of all of our belongings, from cameras to toothbrushes. It soon became apparent this was a bribe tactic. It was extremely frustrating knowing we had covered every detail, had all of our documents in line, and had all of the required vehicle safety supplies, such as road triangles, road flares, fire extinguishers, and spare tires, but we still could not leave the country without paying a bribe. Once settled with the customs officials, we got nailed by the Honduran Federal Police, and then the Honduran military. We were robbed 3 times, all in the last 300 feet of Honduran highway. It was the same story in Nicaragua. There was no way around paying bribes. Maarten, who has traveled throughout all of Africa by car, confirmed that the Honduran-Nicaragua border was by far the worst of all borders he has crossed. We felt defeated.
So this is Leon, Nicaragua. We just arrived. It's approaching sundown on Thursday, May 31st, I believe. It's been a long day.
Long day.
stayed a couple of nights in Leon, just to catch our breath and rest a bit. On Friday, May 31st, we set off to Costa Rica. It looked like we were going to make the deadline. But bumps and potholes in the ravaged roads sheared a bolt in the manifold just below the carburetor housing. We leaked out engine coolant and the truck overheated. Maarten towed us into Rivas, where a mechanic, upon looking at the truck, informed us it would not be ready until the following Monday. Maarten was out of time and behind schedule. The following morning, we had to say our goodbyes. Alex and Maarten pushed on into Costa Rica. Scott and I were going to stay behind and wait for the truck. It was a strange day. After all this way, just another 20 miles to go. Still, Scott and I were not going to see Costa Rica. But we didn't really care. We were so thrashed from the road, we were looking forward to laying low in San Juan and pretty much do nothing at all. We got a kick out of watching tourists on the beach, who most certainly traveled here by plane, fresh, sprightly, and excited. Scott needed to be back in Albuquerque in another week or so to prepare for his research trip to Africa. So we were pretty much going to blast our way back north, through Nicaragua, Honduras, El Salvador, Guatemala, and Mexico.
Zach and I are in Puerto Escondido, Mexico, and this is maybe the most beautiful place I've ever seen. Beaches are amazing, town's welcoming. I feel like we kind of earned it too, you know, it's been a lot of driving. It's been 9 hour days of driving at least every day. I can think of 2 days off in the last 2 weeks, sorry, 3 weeks. This is another nice day off for us.
Scott and I enjoyed spending our last days together, touring the Pacific Highway of Mexico. I dropped him off in the airport in Puerto Vallarta, where he flew back to Albuquerque. He still needed to prepare for his trip to Lake Victoria in Africa. I was now alone and still pretty deep in Mexico. I continued working my way up the west coast, and it was in Los Mochis, Sinaloa, where I received some startling news about what laid ahead on Highway 15, near Obregón, Sonora. The Yaqui native community was protesting the diversion of their fresh water resources north to the city of Hermosillo, a city basically out of water. The Sonoran government decided it would take water from the Yaqui farmland. The protest composed of an all-out roadblock on Highway 15. They barricaded the road with tractors, buses, and automobiles. The alternate route around the roadblock traversed the Sierra Madres, a mountain chain in Sinaloa. Locals urged me not to chance the Sierra Madres, as recent gun battles between rival drug cartels and military had claimed the lives of numerous innocent bystanders. My only option was to ferry across the Sea of Cortez to La Paz in Baja Sur. The detour would add an additional 3 days to my route. Turned out, I discovered one of the most beautiful places on Earth. Baja California Sur is one of the most beautiful places I have ever experienced. It was dry, barren, stark. Its heat and terrain, unforgiving. But a place clean and vast, quiet and peaceful. The crystalline waters of the Sea of Cortez was the perfect contrast to this desolate desert. This landscape invites a certain type of consciousness, an experience in the absolute moment.
Here we are. Here I am. In Santa Spac, Bahia Concepcion. Sea of Cortez. Solo mission day. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 maybe. Beaches are beautiful here. Good place, really chill. Just two-lane highway, barren, nothing out there. Beautiful turquoise water. It's pretty amazing.
I made my way up Baja California and crossed into the United States at Mexicali into California. Border Patrol agents were blown away when I responded to Nicaragua in regards to their inquiries as to my point of origin. It was even a little unbelievable to myself, looking back and realizing the total time and distance on the road. We experienced so much in a relatively small amount of time. I had completed the 7,000 mile plus loop through 7 countries and made it back to New Mexico, up the middle Rio Grande Valley by way of the old Camino Real. Maarten remains in Costa Rica, where the recent eruptions of Turrialba, Paus, and Rincón de la Vieja have kept him extra busy. Alex continues to enjoy his time working towards his master's degree in geophysics at Oregon State University. Scott went on to spend a month surveying and sampling waters throughout Uganda. He continues to teach and research freshwater resources as a professor at the University of Calgary in Western Canada. As for myself, I continue to explore the elements of New Mexico that speak to me, that move me, and have provoked my imagination. With each homecoming to this place, I bestow a deeper, more intimate, personal context to this enchanted land, its history, and people.